God is our refuge and strength. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way, though its waters roar. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. God is within her. She will not fall. God, be still and know that I am God.
I will be exalted among nations. I will be exalted.
Turn to me and be saved, says the Lord. For I am God, and there is no other.
If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just. He will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Today, once again, we honor the mercy and grace of God, and we pray together. Oh, dear Lord Jesus Christ, you know my poor soul and my great failing, which I confess before you alone with an open heart. I find that I do not have the kind of willpower I ought to have, and that I am in daily failing as a sinful human being. And you know that I desire to have such will, but my enemy leads me bound and captive. Redeem me, a poor sinner, according to your divine will and loving grace, from every evil and temptation. Strengthen and increase in me the true Christian faith. Grant me patience in persecution and in every adversity. You said to St. Peter that he should forgive not only 7 times, but forgive Lord, you ask us to come to you for confidence, so we come. And according to your promise, we confess all our sins and iniquities. May your will be done. Amen. Upon this, your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of the word, and in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And we say together, Amen. We join in the Kyrie hymn 31. Please be seated.
Also.
from sin and every evil, that all my doings in life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. We join in our next hymn.
The portico of the Lord.
For 8 more days they consecrated the temple of the Lord itself, finishing on the 16th day of the first month. Then they went into King Hezekiah and reported, "We have purified the entire temple of the Lord, the altar of burnt offering with all its utensils, and the table for setting out the consecrated bread with all its articles. We have prepared the consecrated all the articles that King Hezekiah removed in his unfaithfulness while he was a king. They are now in front of the Lord's altar." Today I will speak the first part of our first article, first of the each articles, and the congregation then will join in the meeting. So the first article, "I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. What does this mean?" And please join me. "I believe that God has made me and all creatures, that he has given me my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all my members, my reason and all my senses, and still preserves them, that he richly and daily provides me with food and clothing, home and family, property and goods, and all that I need to support this body of life, that he protects me from all danger, guards and keeps me from all evil, and all this purely out of fatherly divine goodness and mercy, without any merit or worthiness in me, for all which I am duty bound to thank and praise, to serve and obey him, this is most certainly true." Our second lesson is from Revelations chapter 14, verses 6 and 7. This reading gives us a picture of angels, and the angel in this two verses is often referred to as Martin Luther, as he was God's messenger to bring people back to the truth of his word. We read, "Then I saw another angel flying in midair, and he had the eternal gospel to proclaim to those who lived on earth, to every nation, tribe, language, and people. He said in a loud voice, 'Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and the springs of water.'" We now read the second part. "I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead." What does this mean? And please join me. "I believe that Jesus Christ is true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, that he is my Lord, who has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood, with his innocent suffering and death, in order that I might be his own, live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, even as he is risen from the dead, lives and reigns through all eternity. This is most certainly true." In our gospel lesson, it reads, "He who has ears, let him hear." We know the seriousness of the tone of these words. Whenever our Lord employs them, it impresses upon us the deep sense of this significant truth. In this instance, as always, his word strikes the conscience of Lutheran Christendom with a hammer blow. On this anniversary of the day when Luther hammered, struck the mighty doors of the Christian church. The Holy Gospel is written in Matthew chapter 11, reading verses 12 through 14. 15. Please rise for the reading. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing, and forceful men lay hold of it. For all the prophets and the law prophesies until John, and if you are willing to accept it, he is the Elijah who was to come. He who has ears, let him hear. The third article. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. What does this mean? I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him, but the Holy Ghost has called me by the gospel, enlightened me in his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith, just as he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth, and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one true faith. In this Christian church, he daily and richly forgives me and all believers all our sins, and at the last day he will raise up me and all the dead, and will grant me and all believers in Christ eternal life. This is most certainly true. You may be seated, and we now ask our confirmation class to come forward for the examination. God's children. We ask you to give us the same truth so that each of us can have the assurance that we are God's children. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As we begin this morning, it will be a little different sermon. It is to try and instruct you and give you information about Luther's hymn, A Mighty Fortress is Our God. This hymn has often been called the Battle Hymn of the Reformation. It is a hymn that is usually saved for Reformation Day, but very rarely used outside of this day. It is a tribute to Martin Luther as one of the three of his greatest accomplishments. Probably Luther's greatest accomplishment was the proclamation that we are saved by God's grace through faith alone. Second was his translation of the Bible into languages of the people. And third was the 37 hymns that he wrote, of which A Mighty Fortress is Our God would rank as the finest. And although this hymn is usually a Lutheran favorite, the story behind the hymn is one that is not often told or appreciated. So today, we will examine this great hymn, now sung in 170 different languages. We will look at two areas. First, its historical content, and second, its application for us. In this hymn, we will see that no matter how dire our circumstances might be in our eyes, God is greater than any of our circumstances, and he will deliver us from our greatest fears through the blood of Jesus Christ. We began this morning then by singing the first two verses of A Mighty Fortress is Our God. shall redeem. When many Christians read or sing the words of this hymn, they find the words difficult to relate to because their experience is not what that of the early Lutherans experienced. While Luther indeed did take a stand for the truth, it was a stand that was very dangerous at the time. Luther put his very life on the line for what he believed, and so did thousands of others. In the Netherlands alone, 50,000 people died because they took their stand with Martin Luther against the Pope and the Roman Catholic Church of their day. It was because of this persecution, then, that Luther penned the words of this hymn. Luther wrote this hymn in order to remind his followers that no matter how bleak the circumstances appeared, they were not to lose hope. The biblical text, then, that he used for inspiration to write our text is our text for today, Psalm 46, reading verses 1 through 3. We read as follows in Jesus' name. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar full and the mountains quake with their surging. O Lord, sanctify us by your truth. Your word is true. Amen. Luther began his life as a professor of Old Testament teaching and was most likely aware of the history of this psalm and chose it because of its history. The story behind the inspired 46th, Psalm 46, comes from 2 Chronicles chapter 20, which tells us of the miraculous victory of the children of Israel during the days of King Jehoshaphat. The story of this miraculous victory is three Nomad tribes, the Moabites, the Amorites, and the Edomites, joined forces against Israel. When Israel had come out of Egypt, God had forbidden them to wipe out these people when they took possession of their promised land. Now, with the threat of being wiped out by them, the people, led by King Jehoshaphat, turned to the Lord in prayer and asked for help. They knew only a miracle from God could save them. After Jehoshaphat prayed to the Lord, the Lord answered the prayer of Israel through the prophet by the name of Jehazabal, who told Jehoshaphat, "You will not need to fight in this battle. Position yourselves, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord." The next morning, as the people got ready to go out to battle, King Jehoshaphat made what must go down in history as one of the strangest strategic decisions in military history. Instead of putting his archers or swordsmen in front, he put the choir in front. This surely must have seemed strange to the people as well, but they went along with Jehoshaphat. When they arrived to do battle, the choir began to sing, "Praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever." And that's when things began really to get strange, because the three armies that they came to fight began fighting amongst themselves. And when dusk had finally cleared, all three armies were dead. The story behind the Psalm 46, and Psalm 46, when we keep that in mind, we can again then begin to appreciate even more the words of this hymn, "A Mighty Fortress is Our God." Luther saw himself in the same position as the Israelites did in Jehoshaphat's day. He saw the many foes in the emperor, Charles V, the Pope, and even the possibility of his own townspeople being against him. But were they really against Luther or something else? They weren't so much against Luther, but what he stood for. Even as The Jews and the Pharisees were angry at Jesus when our Savior walked on this earth because the preaching of salvation by faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone was so foreign to them who had tried to make themselves worthy of heaven by the law. Luther recognized that he could not win the battle for truth by himself. In fact, it was not really his battle. That's why he writes the last verse, or the last line of verse 1, on earth is not his equal. And in verse 2, with might of ours cannot be done, soon were our loss afflicted. Luther knew he was in Jehoshaphat's position. The battle would have to be fought and won by the Lord himself. Luther was willing to trust God completely to fight the battle against the emperor and the pope. And that's why Luther calls God a mighty fortress, who he saw as a trusty shield and weapon. Yet Luther's battle was not really against the emperor or the pope. He recognized his real enemy was the old evil foe, Satan himself. Luther could have been terrified enough to deny the truth, but he was not afraid, even as he writes this hymn. Though devils all the world should fill, all eager to devour us, we tremble not, we fear no ill, they shall not overpower us. Why didn't Luther tremble? Why was he so fearless? Verse 2 puts it this way. Whom God himself elected. Ask ye, who is this? Jesus Christ it is, of Sabbath order. And there is no other God. He holds the field forever. You see, Luther understood the importance of the cross of Jesus Christ. He knew a Savior that had lived the perfect life that Luther could never. He believed in a Savior who had died a horrible death on Good Friday to bring him pardon and forgiveness. He believed in a Savior that had not only been crucified, but also raised from the dead. And he trusted in a Savior that promised, "Behold, I am with you always." Luther's courage and confidence was not in himself at all, but in Jesus Christ. He knew he could not win the battle against Satan, or the Pope, or the Emperor, or anyone else of his own. He saw God fighting for him in these words. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. We now join in verses 3 and 4.
Thank you.
that Luther knew that faith grows in persecution, because in persecution, believers are preserved from taking comfort and security in the world. We are sons and daughters of Luther through faith. We should have the same courage as he did. Luther and his followers could have had plenty of reason to be afraid, as they were threatened with loss of property, the slaughter of their wives and children, as well as they themselves. And that is why Luther writes, "And take they our life, goods, fame, child, and wife, let these all be gone, they have nothing won." It almost sounds to us like Luther didn't love his wife or children or care about them. That's simply not the case. He is simply responding to the fear that he and his followers must have faced with faith. In King Jehoshaphat's day, the kingdom remained his despite the tremendous threat. In face of the old evil foe and that scowled fierce at Luther and sought to bring great harm to him, Luther prevailed. The Pope and the Emperor had no appreciation for God's true word, yet it was the word of God that won the day for Luther and for his followers, and it is the same for us. The kingdom ours remaineth were words that were true for Luther, and they are true for us as well. Because we are the blood-bought children of God from the cross of Jesus Christ, we are part of his kingdom. There is nothing except unbelief then that can take us away from that. Just as God gave Luther his good gifts and the Holy Spirit in the 16th century, so he continues to do the same for all believers today in the 21st century. And he will continue to give to believers those good gifts until Christ's return. The words of the hymn, "A mighty fortress is our God," tend to be somewhat romanticized by many Christians today. But for Luther and his followers, they weren't just words. This hymn expresses their strong faith in God, who would fight the battle against error and unbelief for them. They were words that gave Luther and his followers courage in the midst of danger, enabled them to face great danger with faith instead of fear. Luther's words of this hymn are both timely and timeless. And although the words were written in 1529, they are timeless because they hold such great truth for us today. And that truth is this: the same God who fought for King Jehoshaphat, for the nation of Israel, the same God who fought for Martin Luther and his followers, is the same God who fights for you and me today against sin, death, and the devil himself. Yes, a mighty fortress is our God, a trusty shield and weapon. Amen. Please rise for the blessing. And now may the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. And we join in hymn number 283 for our offertory.
We give thee but thine own, whate'er the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. Amen. Today we have the Lord's Prayer with responses, so please rise and open your bulletins and please join in the Lord's Prayer with explanations. I invite you to lift up your hearts to God and pray as Christ our Lord taught us. With these words, God tenderly invites us to believe that He is our true Father, that we are His true children, so that we may pray to Him as boldly and confident as dear children ask their dear Father.
Hallowed be thy name.
God's name is certainly holy by itself, but we pray in this petition that we too may keep it holy.
Thy kingdom come.
God's kingdom certainly comes by itself with our prayers, but we pray in this petition that it may also come to us. God's good and gracious will certainly is done without our prayer, but we pray in this petition that it may be done among us also. God surely gives daily bread without our asking, even for all the wicked, but we pray in this petition that He would lead us to realize this and to receive our daily bread with thanksgiving. Would not look upon our sins or because of them deny our prayers. For we are worthy of none of these things for which we ask, neither do we deserve them. But we ask that He would give them all to us by grace, for we daily sin much and surely deserve nothing but punishment. So we too forgive from the heart and gladly do good to those who sin against us. God surely tempts no one to sin, but we pray in this petition that God would guard and keep us so that the devil, the world, and our sinful flesh may not deceive us or lead us into false belief, despair, or other great shameful sin. And although we be thus tempted by them, we pray that we may overcome and win the victory. In conclusion, we pray in this petition that our Father in heaven would deliver us from every evil that threatens body and soul, property and reputation, and finally, when our last hour comes, grant us a blessed end and graciously take us from this world of sorrow to Himself in heaven. Be sure that these petitions are acceptable to our Father in heaven and are heard by Him, for He Himself has commanded us to pray in this way and has promised to hear us. Therefore we say, Amen. Yes, it shall be so. Please be seated now as we continue with hymn number 304.
Oh,
on page 24 of the preface. The Lord be with you.
Oh, Christ, thou that art God,
rise for a closing prayer. O omnipotent, eternal, and merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, by the Holy Spirit you gather the church from the human race and preserve it in the midst of the holy deposit in the heavenly, in our heavenly home. We humbly praise you and submissively ask that you preserve the savoring doctrine of your word among us undefiled. The daily extent, often more wicked, the bounds of sin, but yet you extend also the kingdom of the church. Set aside for us in this dark world the light of your word. Out of our boundless mercy, we ask, do not allow it to be extinguished or to obscure again by the fog of human tradition. Give to us your word as a sanctuary for our soul. Prevent, we ask, that Satan and the corruption of men be turned into poison for us. Put to death in us the corrupt lusts of the flesh, which thirst after earthly things, so that we may taste the delights of the hidden manna, the spiritual things of your word. Be the one who experienced this sweetness and tasted it, and no one tastes it whose mouth is not full of the Lord. Your word is a word of spirit and life. It is a word of light and grace. Take away the fleshly desires that corrupt human hearts, so that it may be enlighten us through the leading it through that light. From the light of your word arise in our hearts the light of saving faith, so that in your light we see. In that light, the word, we see the light of your Son, just as the heavenly manna once fell from heaven in the wilderness, so also, by the hearing of your word, our hearts are filled with your Spirit. And this favor and inflame our cold and lukewarm flesh to heat up through that light. May your holy seed of the word take root in our hearts, so that the Holy Spirit bring forth strengthening and produce abundant crop. Guard, O Lord, the vine which is your church, in which that seed is sown, and the fruit of eternal life is harvested. Surround it with a hedge of angels, lest wild boars or foxes root it up. Indeed, the former by violent persecution and later by deceitful seductions. Erect a high watchtower of your word to keep it safe from devastation. And for a time it shall have seemed good to you to squeeze the clusters of grapes of the vine in the winepress of the cross and to subject them to affliction. May they first become ripe by the favor of your grace, so that they may show forth the sweetest fruits of faith and patience. Whatever is placed upon the young hearts of our believers, let your word shine through. Bring about our souls a change from ridicule and persecution to praise and faith, hope, and love in you. Out of this church militant, carry us then forward to the church triumphant. May this profitable tabernacle be changed at last into the most beautiful and everlasting temple, the kingdom of heaven. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.